I hope y'all could handle another Louisiana story. I'm afraid I tire you with those. At 8 o'clock, someone's cell phone alarm went off, one of those burr, burr, burr. It's like the anti-Louisiana story alert. But this story actually has a connection to Emmanuel Parish, and I'm excited to share it with you. It happened in 1805. I wasn't there. But in the early spring of 1805, a ship docked at New Orleans. And among the passengers was a minister. And something that happened when the United States made the Louisiana Purchase and the French trefoil was taken down from the Cabildo and the Stars and Stripes were raised, one of the things that changed was that people now had freedom of religion. For under France, they had to be Roman Catholic. So when the Stars and Stripes were raised, a few Protestants in New Orleans came out of hiding. And they were of different denominations, and there weren't enough of them for each denomination to have a church, so they all came together. Imagine that, Christians all coming together. And they put out word that they needed a minister, and several answered the call with letters. And the one they chose was this minister who got off the boat on this day in 1805, just in time to celebrate Easter with this church that was being called Christ's Church. His name was Philander Chase, and he was an ancestor of beloved Dr. Ralph Chase, now of blessed memory. I'm a member here at Emmanuel, and Virginia's here in the congregation today. And he came to New Orleans from Connecticut, and he spent 6 years there, and he was such a good pastor and a good theologian that all of these different Protestants decided to join the Episcopal Church. And Christ's Church is now called Christ Church Cathedral in New Orleans. And if you ever visit, it's on 7th and St. Charles, and you can go to service there and enjoy it, and they would make you feel welcome. Philander Chase spent 6 years there in New Orleans, and then he headed home to Connecticut for a short time, and then there was a call that went out for missionaries to the Ohio Territory, and he answered that call, and he went out to the Ohio Territory with energy and vigor, and he established congregations and started working among the Native Americans, and when there was enough of energy to start a new diocese, he was elected the first bishop of Ohio. And when word got back to England that there was a new brother bishop in the ranks of the Anglican fold, they were shocked and appalled to find out that his Episcopal palace was a log cabin. How can a lordly bishop live in such squalor, they thought. Well, Philander Chase worked hard there in Ohio. He established many congregations, started a college called Kenyon College, and a school of theology called Bexley Hall. And when things were going well in Illinois, he moved on to Illinois and repeated the same work. And there's a school of theology, Seabury Western Theological Seminary near Chicago that he helped to begin. A palace, that's what the English bishops thought a bishop needed, because in their tradition, a bishop is a comfortable government job. You're in the House of Lords, you get this nice place to live in London. Most bishops in that time didn't even ever visit their diocese. They had underlings that would take care of things in their diocese. So it was a pretty cush job. But Philander Chase needed no palace to establish his Episcopal identity. He needed only to serve God and serve the church. James and John, give us a place, one at your right hand, one at your left, when you come into your glory. And if you've got a palace for us, that would be nice as well. James and John, they do not understand what Jesus is about. Or is it that they understand and they refuse to understand, though? Their request, it stirs up anger among the other 10 disciples. And Jesus comes upon them, and they're arguing amongst themselves, I were Jesus, there would be some anger. And maybe that's true for Jesus. Maybe he's angry that he spent all this time with the disciples. He's told them as they make their way to Jerusalem what's going to happen. The Son of Man will be handed over. He will be killed, but on the third day, he will be raised. Does he rebuke the disciples for their hard-headedness? Does he expel them from his school of discipleship? No, he settles in for some further explanation. I'm going to keep telling these guys until they get it. He takes advantage of that teachable moment. And that is something that is such an encouraging word for us when we don't understand. I don't know about you, but I think for me that's often. It's an encouraging word for us when we have much to learn, which for me is often. Our Lord Jesus is patient. He's patient with us because, as the writer to the Hebrews says, he has shared our humanity. He knows what it's like to walk in our shoes. He is persistent with us. He keeps on teaching, and he deals gently with us when we are wayward and ignorant. He does all that until the light begins to come on and we begin to understand. We begin to see him as he truly is. As he truly is. The suffering servant bearing the sins of many. The great high priest, the source of eternal salvation for all who believe in him. A palace. What would Philander Chase have done with a palace, with such creature comforts as that? I think what would have happened was he would have been fawned over by adoring lay folk and sycophant clergy. It would have been something like going to diocesan convention where the bishop shows up and all the people from the different parishes are so happy to see him and the clergy are on their best behavior. Or at least some of them are. Would have been nice, maybe, to be fawned over and to have the clergy be at least obedient at face value, but Philander Chase found a better, a higher purpose. He found that better purpose in giving himself to Christ and the church in servanthood. He lived in a stifling, subtropical, humid environment for 6 years, a place where ice was a luxury. You know, when the ships came to New Orleans and they loaded up their holds with King Cotton and they brought it back north and unloaded them, you know what they did before they made their trip back to New Orleans? They loaded the hold with ice. And whatever didn't melt by the time they got to New Orleans, they would sell for a pretty penny. It was a place where ice was a luxury. And he spent 6 years there in the days before air conditioning. I don't know. And then he ventured out into untamed wilderness. Yes, Ohio and Illinois were once wilderness. And he did all that to share in the privilege of being part of the unfolding kingdom of God. And that is a purpose in which we too share as we give ourselves. As we give ourselves in reverent and heartfelt worship. As we give ourselves in devotion to growing in the knowledge and love of the Lord and learning the Lord's ways, as we give ourselves to serving others in the Lord's name, as we offer ourselves by offering our time, our aptitudes, our resources, our treasure, even offering our weaknesses, because Paul will tell us that God can take our weaknesses and turn them into strengths for the kingdom. We offer the whole of ourselves in order to share in the privilege of being part of the continual unfolding of God's kingdom until the great day.